Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Okay, we're ready to go. It's nine o'clock, our meeting starting time. I'd like to welcome everyone to this morning's meeting. Before we start with the official agenda, I'd like to ask Commissioner Vaughn to give our invocation.
I want to take this opportunity to acknowledge that next Monday is Marine Corps birthday, and next Tuesday is Veterans Day. And in response to that, I'd like to give special attention to that. A veteran is someone who, at one point in his life, wrote a blank check made payable to the United States of America for an amount of up to and including my life and yours. Because I wanted to do special attention to the veterans, I went to Phyllis over in the Veterans Administration, and she came up with this prayer. It's going to be my honor to deliver it to you. Eternal Father, it is with thankful hearts that we lift our prayers to you. We ask you to protect in a special way those who are fighting for us today and for those who fought for us in the past for the country we love. Bless them and take care of them. If they are tired, give them strength. If they are wounded and suffering, give them comfort. Grant them strength and wisdom and help them through your power and timeless love. We thank you for the life skill and dedication of those who served, and thank you for the sacrifice each of them has made for our great nation. Amen.
Amen.
And it was 8:59, by the way.
I'm sorry.
I go by universal coordinated time.
You go by the county TV clock.
County's wrong as usual.
Commissioner Lashley is ill this morning and will not be attending our meeting. We have four people signed up for public comments, which is a period which public is invited to speak for up to 3 minutes on any topic they so desire. So we'll start off. The first one that signed up is Brenda Everett. Ms. Everett?
Good morning, Commissioners. I'm Brenda Everett. I'm a mother. I'm a grandmother. And this year, I became a full-pledged senior adult, because most people don't consider you a senior adult till you turn 60. My question and concern is the Pleasant Grove Recreation Department. We have asked questions of what's going to happen to it since the fire. We have not been able to tell that anything constructive is going on with it. We've been told that it may be torn down. If this is a case and it's not rebuilt, where will our children go in the summer when there's no school and the parents are needing summer camps? Because this is in a central location for the people in the Pleasant Grove area for their children to go and be cared for. If it's not there, then they have to travel here to Graham or to Mebane or even to Burlington. And a lot of times this is out of the way. My children and my grandchildren have partake in the athletic programs that's been held there. The senior adults that have the programs, the art classes, the bingo, the dance classes, and the Big Daddy, they're being shipped off miles away, and with the price of gas and things this day and time, this puts a burden if you're on a fixed income. And we love going there. It's a fellowship. It's a exercise place. We could go and exercise. 2 years ago, I had knee surgery, and I could go there and work out and work on my knee. I had another knee surgery in July of this year, and with the building not being fixed up, I couldn't go there. I have to go to either Mebane, to the Art Center, or to Graham to do my walking when the weather's bad, or to work out. We really need it, and we don't understand why nothing has been done. Another lady is going to speak on it also. She's got a little more information than I do, but we really need it, because out there, there's nothing else offered, nowhere for the kids to go after school. And if you know, if the kids don't have somewhere to go that's constructive, then what happens? They go into gangs, they get with wrong crowds, and it's bad. So if you would please consider about rebuilding it, replenishing it, whatever it takes, because we really, really need it. And it's been there for so many years, so many people went to school there, and they don't want to see the school tore down.
Thank you, Ms. Everett.
Ms. Everett, somebody called, it might have been Ms. Thomas called me, last week or a week and a half ago, and I checked with staff. There's a meeting coming up this week with school personnel. They're looking at three or four different options, maybe as many as five different options, but certainly we want to do what's best for the community out there, and we'll keep the community apprised of what's going on out there.
Brian Hague will give us an update once the speakers are finished speaking on this topic. Ruth Wade Thomas.
Good morning, Commissioners, and to the audience. I want to add to what Mrs. Everett has said. First of all, I want to thank you for allowing me time to address you in matters of our concern. And to those of you who are vying for your seats tomorrow, good luck. I want to say that to you. I am Ruth Wade Thomas, a Pleasant Grove Township citizen, and I wanted to express, in addition to what she said, our concerns regarding the recreation center. As you know, it was burned during the spring. And as she said, we've not really learned any definite plans as to how this will be handled. Now, I'm just here to share with you some of our requests and let you know what is going on. In addition to what she has said, that facility has permitted us to enjoy crafts, bingo, socialization, etc. And it's been a place for the youth to have baseball, basketball, and tournaments as well. I live right around the corner, and that has been a fixture there, even though I did not attend the school. And the primary reason, I would say, is because, as you know, our society is suffering from a condition called obesity. And in order to be physically fit, and try to maintain good health, as we are encouraged to do, and as we know personally we need to do, the exercise equipment is equipment that we as individuals are unable to purchase for ourselves. And this means that a lot of the senior citizens and many of us who are on fixed income are unable to travel to Burlington or to a greater distance, especially with today's gas costs, even though they're going down, but who knows when they're going to go up. So this facility is just a great place for us. It's safe. We feel safe. It's well maintained. So we would just like to ask you to rebuild or refurbish as taxpayers and as concerned citizens. Now, in fact, I have a document wherein over 850 individuals have signed requesting these same things that I just mentioned, to refurbish or to rebuild. But please just don't destroy it. Mr. Engel, it was not I who called you. But anyway, that's okay. I did call the office to learn about when we were meeting. So As Alamance County citizens, taxpayers, we just wanted you as commissioners to learn of our concerns and the desires that we would like. And I thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Thomas. Denny Jeffries.
Good morning, Commissioner. My name is Benny Jeffries. As a matter of fact, I sat at the PCA at the Recreation, as Parents Coaches Association, in early 1975 through the 90s. We learned that this recreation took a lot of kids off the street through basketball, baseball, softball. This facility is located in the heart of a lot of drug dealing, as we know, and it occupied the kids there to come and work, and we started a lot of programs through the parents and through the coaches there. This facility, it come to me when I heard the statement, was as disbelief. A facility has been utilized in so many ways, as for the senior citizens, for the young kids, for the people that have time to work in the community. This is a focal point that people come into the community, join together to help situations that occur in the community of Pleasant Grove. Believing that these things would even come into a mind where things are used to help the community, to build the people up, to raise the young people up. I couldn't understand the reasoning here. I would definitely say rebuild this place, vitalize it in so many different ways. Thank you.
A.R. Dickey.
I'm a senior citizen. And I pay about $2,000 taxes, and I think y'all ought to done already fixed that school up out there. You're dragging your feet. All the kids and everything that use the recreation facilities and everything, we have one that went on to be a high-ranking basketball. John Owen Curry, y'all probably know of him. He's in the NBA or something on that, a star basketball player. Got his practice right there at that facilities. And I think you ought to build us an indoor swimming pool out there. It'd be nice for these older people. Get these old bones and everything. And everybody done took over everything, I guess, so I'll close out.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Thank you, Mr. Anyone else on the this particular subject? Okay, if not, Brian Haygood, our Parks and Recreation Director, is here. And, Brian, why don't you give the audience an update on where we stand?
Well, as Mr. much
Chairman,
as possible.
Before Brian starts, if I could explain a little bit what's happened on this. After the fire, it was insured, and we've had a problem with the insurance company from day one in trying, and we finally, I think, had that settled, but there was a problem from day one on that. But I don't know where the rumor came that the county was going to tear that gym down, because it has never been my intent at all to tear that gym down. It's always been my intent to fix the gym. And as far as I'm concerned, the gym will be repaired and reopened. So I want to squelch that rumor right off the bat that I had no intent and still have no intention of tearing that gym down. And in fact, my argument has always been, you tear a gym down, you're never going to get one back. And we just don't have enough gyms now. We are meeting with the schools this week. They actually own that gym. We lease it from them. They own all of the gyms in the county. And we're trying to see what we can do and possibly expand our use of the school's gyms. But I understand your feelings about it, but please, it's never been any intent to tear that building down at all. And excuse me, Brian has a lot more details on it, Commissioner.
Well, as you know, we came before you reported the fire occurred back in June. And in that interim, our staff immediately began trying to find some replacement sites for the programs that had been going on out there. We knew this was going to be a long process, mainly to do with the age of the building and the attempt to try to look at the building and see what would need to be done to bring it, not only to repair it, but to bring it to today's code. And that has been a difficulty. And as Mr. Smith stated, we have had some problems dealing with the insurance company. We've tried to relocate everything that we could. We relocated the summer camp, which was priority. Remember when the fire broke out, we were about a week out from being able to start the summer camp, and we worked with ABSS to move that up to Pleasant Grove, and we've had some success working and trying, particularly the bingo program, was relocated over to Lakeview. We know that's not a permanent solution, but in this interim, we've tried to find homes. So we know the importance of the center out there in that part of the county. We have a lot of kids that play ball through there and a lot of folks, as you can see, that come every day. I know one of the most used features we have out there is the exercise equipment, which has all been damaged in the fire. It's inside the gym, and between the smoke and heat damage, it's pretty much ruined. And we won't be able to replace that equipment until we can settle up with the insurance company, because it was part of the contents that was covered too. So as Mr. Schmidt has summed it up completely, the desire is not there to completely remove the building. I think there's some questions about how best to bring it back and what that process should be. So, and anything that we do renovation-wise or any changes to the building will necessitate that I'll be back in front of this board. So it wouldn't be, if there are any changes made or whatever the process turns out to be, I'll be coming back in front of you to ask permission to make any movements that we're going to make. We'll try to make sure the community knows before that to get their input too.
My son used to play ball up there about 20 years ago and walk through the building. All the rooms there on the front, like all the activity rooms are on the front there, if I'm not mistaken, as you go in the door. And they were always full of people doing things. And the gym, I thought, was, a very sturdy structure. Yes. Did it have a tile floor?
It did, yes, sir.
On the court, what are you going to do when you redo it?
The tile floor is pretty much ruined. I think the water damage that the building sustained has all popped up. It can't be buffed or anything like that. We'll probably rely on whatever the insurance company deems we can do.
I mean the basketball court.
Yes, it's ruined. It's going to have to be replaced. We have been able to work with Hall River Elementary, Pleasant Grove Elementary. Now, Pleasant Grove Elementary is just a few miles up the road. We're going to be able to host practices and games there this season. So the kids, we hope to keep them as close to the community where they have been playing historically as we can. But the gym floor and is in pretty bad shape and will have to be replaced, and I'm sure we'll rely on whatever the insurance company will do.
Brian, I know that dealing with insurance companies can be long and tedious. Do we have any kind of time frame?
I'm not sure if I can tell you an exact time frame. I think once we do some discussions with the school system and get everything squared away with them, several of the architects from the county and from the insurance company have been up there and looked at the property. We want to try to come to a resolution as quickly as we can. But I right now I can tell you we're not planning on having youth basketball there this season, which we started we start today, and that will run through February. The damage to the building was pretty extensive, so whenever it's county and the insurance company come to terms, what's going to be done and the work's going to be done, it will probably take several months. I would not be surprised to see it fixed and redone.
Was it adequately insured? In
yes.
Your opinion, was that school system insurance or county?
It was the county. We keep the building under lease, so we assume all liability for any damages incurred to it during the time that we have it leased.
Yes, ma'am, you had a question?
Yes, thank you for allowing me this time to speak. I want to speak on what the gentleman over here said. We're here for the gym, but we also is asking for the other parts for the senior citizens to be restored, because as you know, a lot of senior citizens on fixed income, they can't afford to pay that high insurance, and the more that gym keeps people like me up there walking and exercising, my health is better, and that means that I'm able to go about my everyday living. And basically, what I'm hearing from them is basically the gym. And what we have heard, that they was not going to tear the gym down, but they was going to destroy all the rest of the facilities out there. So this is what our cry is today, that you will hear this. And think of us, too, as taxpayers in that community that has been out there. And you will also consider us, too, as we grow older. And I thank you for this time.
Brian, does that include that other area too?
The damage to the wing parts that the lady is talking about, it was quite extensive, and they are nowhere near, I would, and based on the meetings and the things that I've been out there, inspections, nowhere near today's code. The desire of the department will be to continue to provide all services that were out there before. That would either be in the existing building, the wings that exist now. If that's not possible, and I can't tell you that it would be possible due to the nature of the damage to the building, we will do everything we can to continue to provide that service. It may be in a different space. It may be something else done to the gymnasium or some newer space. But we share the same desire, that you'd be able to come out there and exercise and do all the programs that have been in place. I don't know that I could commit to you right now and tell you that those wings will, without fail, be saved. I think that's going to take some more doing than I can tell you right now. But I can tell you that the desire of the department is to continue to provide the same services with the same equipment available and hours of operation and everything else.
Which is older, Eli Whitney or Pleasant Grove?
I think Eli Whitney is a little bit older than Pleasant Grove. The gymnasium at Eli Whitney, though, was constructed in 1950. So I'm not exactly sure off the top of my head when the building at Pleasant Grove was built, but of course at Whitney all we have is the gymnasium itself. The problem at Whitney, we have these same programs at Eli Whitney. We have had the exercise rooms, the senior programs. That's when you have Miss Bailey come up, and that building was not designed for that type of program. We have recently been able to work with the fire department at Whitney, and we've relocated the programs that were happening downstairs to the fire department. Good thing about Eli Whitney, Pleasant Grove, is it is all one level, so you're not having to negotiate stairs. But I would assure the board that if the programs are not done in the existing wings, they will be done on the property somehow. It just, we'll wait to see what the architects and the insurance company say about the other existing portions of the building.
Well, if we invest money in that, which we should, that project, it should be something that's going to last another 50, 60 years rather than just patchwork. So I would support that.
So is that included enclosed swimming pool?
that's the first I've heard of the enclosed swimming pool.
What about heated?
Heated swimming pool.
Definitely heated.
Okay. And you know, it's obvious that there's a strong community sentiment in Pleasant Grove. I think Mr. Dickey, I recognize Mr. Dickey, and I know he attends our bingo programs and brings produce, for folks to play. It's a good community, and it's a very strong family-oriented group up there. So.
Any other questions? Pleasant? Okay. Thank you. Okay. Mr. Goff is here. I know he didn't get here to time to sign up. But Mr. Goff, you want to speak for 3 minutes? You're allowed. Thank you.
Okay. Most of y'all don't know me. My son was hit out on 49 in Belmont, October 7th. We have no street lights, no sidewalks, no way for these kids to get from one point to another. Now the church is not allowing them to even play in the parking lot due to my son's accident. They ran them all off. Okay, so now we got kids that ain't got no place to play out there, period. Okay, and I've talked to several of y'all. Okay. Everything's in the works. I'm trying to get a homeowners association together now. From what I was told, the DOT would be willing to put maybe sidewalks in, but the county wouldn't pay for the upkeep. There ain't much upkeep on sidewalks. But if we've got a homeowners association together, homeowners association to do upkeep. So that's something y'all gonna be seeing me on pretty good bit for the next few months.
And I know we've had a couple conversations that DOT is doing a study.
Jason Martin too, I think, from
Jason.
See here,
he's back there.
Yeah, Jason's up to date.
He's supposed to be
looking into it.
Right. And, I mean, I've talked to one of the churches up there about maybe trying to get it incorporated, if not getting the homeowners association together. Yeah. Okay. That way, I've got pictures from Glencoe. I've got pictures from Alamance. Okay? Glencoe runs on solar for their street lights. It don't cost none of the homeowners nothing for solar power for the street lights. Okay, Alamance House is just as close to the road as Belmont. When you step off her front porch, you step onto a sidewalk. I can show you the pictures if y'all want to see them. If y'all want to see them?
I go through there about every other day.
So y'all are familiar then?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Y'all familiar? Belmont's been around as long as Alamance.
Alamance is a town. They have their own.
They got incorporated.
So, yeah, that's a big difference between.
Well, Belmont's, I'm going to push it that way.
But the homeowners association, I think, is
that'd be a quicker,
is a good alternative.
Yeah, it'd be a quicker route to get some sidewalks in.
But we appreciate your effort to make that area a safer pedestrian.
We about had a 18-wheeler hit a school bus this morning there. Okay.
Make a curve.
Because the school bus stops right in the curve, and the 18-wheeler had to lock it up this morning to keep from hitting it. My daughter was getting on the bus. So, it's going to take y'all, the DOT, and everybody in Belmont to get together to do anything about this. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, any other public comments? If not, we'll move on into our formal agenda. The first is the Work First Standard Plan, Susan Osborne.
Good morning. I think we sent you a copy of the plan. You also have a brief executive summary of a couple of pages, and I'll just highlight a couple of things. We have asked, and for the third year in a row, we have received a demonstration grant to work with Alamance County citizens to really try to keep the rolls down and work first and work on some barriers for folks becoming employed and being self-sufficient. We've redone our orientation process and to provide more personal accountability from the beginning. And we've been working with Mr. Albright on a program that he suggested that we get started, a day laborers program, to really work with some of our absent parents, particularly in our child support area, who, because of their criminal record, are having difficulty being employed. So that is a barrier to employment. Transportation, we participate on that countywide transportation task force. We have made a change in this plan. One of them is, at the recommendation of consultation with our community partners, is that the family leave waiver is changing. Single parents used to get 12 months before they had to go to work, and we've narrowed that to 3 months and feel like folks need to be headed out towards supporting their children. We also try to work with benefit diversion to see that if there's a way, if folks have employment history and there's a way we can keep them off Work First by providing a short-term support versus becoming dependent on the Work First check. So we're working on that. You can see that last year we sanctioned 284 customers through the fiscal year as folks weren't complying with parts of child support or substance abuse treatment or their guidelines. So I'll be glad to answer any questions that you have, but in a nutshell, that's our Work First plan. It would be for 2009 through 2011. And with your approval, we'll submit that to the state.
Okay. Have any questions? Have a motion to accept the plan?
Motion.
Second.
Motion second. Any further discussion?
Yeah.
Okay.
I really, I know what it was like 20 or 30 years ago as far as DSS is concerned. In fact, I had a student who, as long as I kept my thumb on that child, he did C work. And I tried to corner him because I felt like he could do better. And I said, Charlie, you know, I really would like to see you graduate from high school. He goes, but Ms. Vaughn, you don't understand. I'm going to do what my family's always done.
Yeah.
Gum. And I'm going, yeah, what is that? He says, I'm going on welfare. And now I see this wonderful turn that you and your department have been very instrumental. And you've been very instrumental in helping a lot of people in Alamance County. We don't know when something will come down our way, and
right.
we would be unfortunate, and that can happen to any of us. So I'm very thankful for the work that you've done and your department has done.
Well, thank you. I think we, over the last 6 or 8 years, we've really refocused our programs to become, you know, we are not the welfare check anymore. In fact, you'll see, I think Sherry Hook has some statistics to show you around Medicaid, but our workforce checks are less than 400 of the more than 25,000 residents we serve. So we really consider ourselves a tool to help folks go to work and be self-sufficient, and that's what this plan reflects.
That's good for the ego. Thank you.
It is. It's good for citizens and for government.
You know, without telling the details of the story, I don't think many commissioners, I've been on our board for 13 years, and I had never had a citizen call me for help.
Yes, sir.
And this situation, I mean, we sit up here and we don't really see what the agencies are doing, hands-on and so forth. And I mean, when this person called me for help, I mean, my heart just I mean, I couldn't even leave to go to work that day till I got involved. And long story short, you know, everybody working together, her problem was solved for the time being.
Right.
And I mean, it just pulls on you.
I thought one thing that was so amazing here was that she's pulled together 25 agencies. Mm-hmm. I can't count them up. Everybody working together to make this grant that you've been able to get come to life.
Well, and that's what it takes, is strong working relationships in the community, because as Commissioner Sutton said, right now there is overwhelming need.
It's going to get worse.
That's right. That's right. And it no one agency can solve all of it. And, you know, we all deplete our funds so quickly that we have to work together and leverage what we have. And that's something we believe in strongly at Social Services.
And I want to compliment the Times News here while Bob's, believe it or not, compliment the paper. He almost fell out of his chair. But they did a good article on assistance for our public.
Yes.
Which I thought front page was excellent. Yes. I appreciate what they did.
Raises the awareness.
Susan, I thought the report was very comprehensive. It was good to see many of your benchmarks have been met already. So I do compliment you.
Well, thank you. Thank you.
Good job.
Thank you.
Any further discussion? If not, all in favor, motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Susan. Next, we have three budget amendments for approval. First is the Health Department. Mr. Bass?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. What you have before you today is a request to allow revenues in the sum of $23,358 in our women, infants, and children's supplemental nutrition program. And this accepting these funds will involve no county match, or there are no county dollars. This is all federal flow-through dollars that come from the state. And we're receiving this increase based upon our performance and increase in the caseload allocation. And as Commissioner Sutton has alluded, you'll probably see more growth in this particular program also over the next couple of months, too. Mm-hmm. So I'd ask the board's willingness to consider accepting these funds.
Okay. We have a motion.
Move.
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? Say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries.
Dr. Bass, yes, I honestly didn't want to, I didn't think you were here. I didn't see you back there. I was going to call you. But I've called once on this topic, and you were out of town, I believe. And I would say a month or so ago, there was an article in the paper where the issue about the alias names, the using of different names at the health department, the article said that, and I'll paraphrase it, that a second name, if offered, would be put in an, quote, information continuation file. And I was under the impression that we weren't going to have any of that going forward. So what's the status of that?
Well, what happened, sir, is like, and I recently had a case where an individual's name was Suarez, and one was spelt with an S and one was spelt with a Z. So the issue is, if we know this particular individual by a particular name, I can assure you that we do know that, that we do know who that particular individual may be. But the other part of this is, it doesn't always particularly be Hispanic surnames, that sometimes individuals may get married or they may get divorced. And so we may have those names whose name could have been Bass and now it's Kramer, whatever. So that would be where we do have like a second name that would be listed.
Well, to just nail it down, if the situation presents itself that presented itself in the past that caused the problem that we had and all the speculation that took place, do we have that remedied to where that won't happen again? Or is that name a second name that somebody wants to use for work purposes, work excuses, so forth and so on? Is that name going to be accepted and so-called be put in an information continuation file?
Well, I'm confident, because the last two times any questions have come up, the folks have come directly to me and asked me, so I would be assuming that responsibility.
Well, what's the answer?
The answer would be that we know who that individual is, and we give the name that they are known as to whomever is requesting the information.
So another name won't be used upon their request other than what's on the file for work purposes. Is that, can I assume that?
That the name that and I guess you, and I'm trying to understand in particular, because even though my name is Barry, that's not my name. My name is Joseph Baird Bass Jr. I go by Barry. So if I go to my doctor and has Barry Bass, they know who I am.
Okay, forgive me. I think we're begging the question here. I think my question is pretty clear. That if somebody else, if you have a name on the file, and they try to come in and say, somebody, I don't care what ethnic background, but they say, I want to use another name, without playing on the words of middle name, first name, last letter, the last name, surname, whatever, clearly want to use a different name.
And the names that we have would match up. Yes, sir.
Okay.
We would know who that individual is, and it would, the names that are being used are not something totally different and outside the names that would show up in a record. I think that's what you're asking. That if a reasonable person were to look at the name on there, that, and they look at the chart and they look at what's being used, they could tie that name back to that individual, clearly. So it would not be something totally out of the realm of a name that would, you know, would not tie that particular person to a particular name.
Okay. Well, I think you understand my point.
Oh, absolutely.
I've heard you. Okay.
And so to my recollection, having seen it, and again, having done it, in the individual case that I saw, that we knew that this particular individual, who they were, and the name that they had showed was the same name was in the record.
Thank you. Sure. We just don't need that to happen again.
All right. We're taking care, and that was part of the charge when I took this position, to make sure that we take care of that.
Thank you.
Sir.
B, budget amendments for the Sheriff's Department. Sure.
Good morning, Commissioners. I'm for you this morning to ask that the Alamance County Sheriff's Office be allowed to transfer from our federal seized drug monies line items to our capital outlay vehicle, so we could purchase some vehicles for the Sheriff's Office, so when the July budget comes, we won't need as many as we are going to need high mileage vehicles. You have before you asking that $20,000 be transferred, but we were going to ask that $40,000 be transferred, but Social Service wanted two of the vehicles that we were going to trade in. And so I'm going to ask this morning, rather than 20, that 40, because they've got to transfer their money from their line item to through Amy for us to be able to get these vehicles. Now is a good time to purchase vehicles. Nobody is selling anything, and we're able to get good prices. These are 2008 used Chargers. We're wanting to purchase three of them and equip them. Like I say, they are used, but they're low mileage, like 13, 14,000 mile vehicles. And Ms. Vaughn, they are 3.56 cylinders. I knew you were getting ready to ask that. We're trying to look at these vehicles and see what type of performance we can get out of them, and if they'll be a longer lasting, and certainly possibly better on gas.
What's going to DSS?
There is a Mercury, Montego, and a Impala, Chevrolet Impala. And if we had the money, we'd love to just give them to social services and bought. But we're, as our federal money is coming in, we're trying to replace vehicles with high mileage that would not be good out on road at real high speeds, but would last over a period of time, somebody like social services or things like that.
I will make the motion that we do accept this, but I do want to ask you a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Do we have a second?
Second. Okay.
And I know this is coming right out of the blue, and you may not be able to answer it. What are we paying for gas, oil gas, a year?
Okay, we have contracted with the city of Burlington. They get their gas at a real low rate, and I can't remember like a cent over whatever they get it for to help offset the billing cost. I can't remember the exact amount, but gas is up and down, and the city of Burlington's gas is up now, so I can't tell you, but I can tell you we're getting it much lower through the city of Burlington than we would out here at the gas stations. But I'll be glad to give you a month-by-month thing if
no,
you
want me
to.
They don't. Also, the Alamance County Transportation Authority contracts with the city to buy gas. They don't have to pay the state tax. I'm not sure about the federal tax, but it's considerably less per gallon than
it is
retail stores.
You're probably looking at about 25-37% less right. per gallon by doing it that way. I would love someday see Alamance County get their own gas pumps and could possibly help with the amount of vehicles we now have with social service and other county vehicles. And I know that's down the road, but it would be good because.
Good idea. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Let's see. All in favor of the motion, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you very much.
Now we have two for social services. Susan, you want to handle those?
Yes. Number 56. Commissioner Sutton, you'll be glad to know this is an additional $25,000 for our crisis in energy. That's to help folks in this high, difficult economic times to help them with their heating-related emergencies. Just so you'll know, this is 100% pass-through funds, but we got an email Friday that we'll be adding an additional $130,000 to that as soon as we can get that budget amendment over as well.
That's where I get the most calls is from the energy-related help.
Yes. That'll take us to a total of about $364,000 this year, which is up about $5,000 over last year. And we understand that we are North Carolina is slated to get some additional funds as a result of some federal funds as well. So I think we'll see significant increase in help this year available. There are limits of how much we can spend per customer. The second budget amendment, number 57, is 100% money. This is part of the ROPE operating grant, and this is our second allotment of funds that we assist Work First recipients.
Okay, do we have a motion to accept both 56 and 57?
Move.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Not all in favor say aye.
Uh-huh.
All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Sue. Next, Jason. Ordinance appeal.
Good morning, Commissioners. As you'll recall, at the last meeting, we tabled this issue until today. The appellant was not present that day, and I do not believe Mr. Gonzalez is here or a representative of him again today. I have personally informed him of the time of this meeting and the location of this meeting and when we met last week, and also sent out a certified notice, reminder of the meeting date and time, and strongly encouraged them to attend. That notice was received on the 31st of October. If they are not here, Mr. Chairman, I recommend that we move forward with this appeal. I think all efforts have been made to have them present. My presentation today will be very brief. This is a violation of the dead storage and manufactured homes ordinance. What Christopher just handed out to you was a copy of Mr. Gonzalez's appeal letter. That was included in last month's packets, and I did not get them in this month. So I apologize. Let's just go right into the photos here. These are some photos that were taken by the planning department in September. As you can see, there's the orange poster you see there. That's a notice of violation that we attached to the mobile homes. And you can see heavy vegetation around it. There's a closer photo of it from where I personally put that up on the 18th of September. As a Class 3 mobile home, I'll get more into that in just a second. This is about a week later after we had sent that out and sent out a notice of violation by mail. You can see that some of the grass was cut down and the vegetation was cut down around it. Here's one of the issues that we have with this as well. You can see somebody has removed some of the aluminum siding off of it, exposing the insulation. And you'll also see where the mobile home has been vandalized. You also notice that the door there has been completely removed. There's a closer view of that. Another view. All of these photos are taken from outside of the mobile home as well. Broken windows. The big black line you see there, that's from where there's been graffiti painted inside of the mobile home with language that I felt would be inappropriate to put up here today. There's another view of that. You can see where it's been spray painted on the inside and vandalized, hole knocked in the door there. This is the other side of the mobile home. The sticker there beside the door is where it had originally been registered to a mobile home park. If I remember correctly, it was in Chatham County in the early 90s. Just to kind of go over what the ordinance states on this, the ordinance is pretty specific. Article 1, Section 2D defines a Class 3 mobile home as a manufactured home which rises to a level of significant public nuisance. Such a home may display one or more of the following characteristics. Situated that there is danger of it falling over or turning over, has utilities that are being run by electric cords, is structurally unsound, is a point of concentration of quantities of gasoline, oil, other flammable or explosive materials as evidenced by odor, is a point of collection of garbage, waste, animal waste, or any other rotten or putrescent matter of any kind, has points of access which are not secured or is missing doors and windows, and has parts thereof which are jagged or contain sharp edges of metal or glass. And this is just to go over the section regarding the nonconformance. Basically, they have a period of 30 days to remedy the situation, which in this case I have asked that the mobile home be removed from the property. After 30 days, there is a citation that is sent out with a nonconformance fee of $250 and an additional 7 days to remove the violation. And then after that, a second citation is sent out with a violation or a nonconformance fee of $500 and 3 days to remove the violation. After that, it is a $500 nonconformance fee per day until the violation is removed. And this is just summarizing that information there. Staff recommendation. Staff believes that this mobile home constitutes a Class 3 mobile home as defined by the ordinance based on the following facts. Unsecured points of entry exist, as I showed. There was a missing door, also supported by various graffiti spray painted on the inside of the home. I'm assuming that people have gone into the home and vandalized it. Sharp points of metal or glass. As you saw, there were broken windows and is structurally unsound. Based on discussions with the inspections department, in order to move into the mobile home, engineering reports would have to be filed based on the extent of the repairs. What I also gave you is a notice of condemnation where building inspections has condemned this mobile home based on these same facts. Therefore, staff recommends denial of this appeal and requested a separate motion authorizing the planning department and legal department to proceed with enforcement as prescribed in the order. And with that, I'll be glad to take any questions you have at this time.
Whose land is this on?
Yeah, that's what I was
going to ask. He owns, the appellant owns the property as well. He owns the land and the mobile home.
Have you had complaints?
Oh, yes. This is actually one of the first complaints that the planning department received in regarding this ordinance.
What kind of water system does it have? Well, septic tank.
It is not connected to anything at this point. It was just pulled out there and dropped. It's not set up to septic. It's not set up to a well.
Septic tank, right?
No, to my knowledge, there's nothing out there. I couldn't find anything, even where a building permit was. They had pulled building permits for a mobile home back in the late 90s, I believe it was, but they never followed through with it. Never did any inspections or anything like that. And of course, that expired under statute. So,
I think we provided reasonable time for Mr. Gonzalez to respond, and he hasn't. So I move that we deny the appeal.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Thank you.
Next, Mr. Manager, you have anything?
No, sir.
Okay, we're down to the consent agenda. There's no objection. I'll make a motion that.
Wait a minute.
Okay.
Can we pull C out, please?
Okay.
Senorita.
I make a motion that we approve consent agenda items A, B, D, E, and F. Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Not. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed. Motion carries. Okay. Number C.
Okay. I asked for that to be pulled for a specific reason, and that is that the last time we had the fire marshal came before us to approve fireworks display. I know they follow federal and or state rules and regulations, and they do everything they're supposed to do. Unfortunately, I did receive a complaint from a lady that lived in the area that she did not know that fireworks were to be held one evening. So only reason I'm asking for that to come out is I'm going to ask the media, news media, to please, and one of them just slipped out, to please make it a point to let the public know that fireworks will be in that area, because I promised this lady I'd do this. The only thing I told her she could do is go to her legislators to change state law. That may not happen, so if you folks will make it a point to let people, especially in like in Elon now, make them aware that fireworks will be on display, the noise and everything, I personally will appreciate it, and I will be living up to my promise to this lady. And I, please, don't grin at me.
Do we have a time?
This one's early.
I know that.
This one will be at 7:30.
I mean, is there a where?
The other one was like 10 o'clock.
If they wanted to have them at 1 o'clock in the morning, is there any kind of time stipulation on that?
Be up to the individual town and or area which the shot is taking place, if there's any local noise ordinances that pertain to that.
And it would be up to us where the grant it.
11 o'clock at Elon. Town of Elon at 11 o'clock.
The latest.
Yeah. I mean, noise ordinance goes into effect. Yeah. 7:30
on November 4th.
Elon University for their homecoming. That's tomorrow
sure
night. That's tomorrow night.
You sure that's not an election celebration?
Oh, right. Could coincide with that.
So, I mean, you know, I agree with this and what you're doing, but I just wanted to make it a point to make that announcement, especially for the news media.
Well, I guess the same person called me, and their objection was that to the one, I think, in the Mammon area was sort of late. In the evening, like 11 or 12 o'clock or something, and
it was
kind of startled them, I think. So, okay. Did we have a motion to see? Did we vote on that? Can't remember.
No, okay. We didn't vote on C.
Did we have a motion?
Well, move.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Any further in business? Not meeting adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners' Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Friday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 3 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.